We'll get started in 1 minute. We'll get started in 1 minute. Good morning. As everyone is coming into the room, we are excited that you're here with us today. I am going to take a moment to introduce Mr. Vince Williams. And before I do that, as you join us, please feel free to utilize the chat as you need to. We will have Q&A near the end of this session. We'll try to get to as many questions as we can. We hope you enjoy this session, and certainly we're honored to have such a great keynote speaker with us. My name is Jared Kelly. I am going to introduce Mr. Vince Williams, the president of the Chicago MSDC, to get us started.
Thank you, Jared. Good morning. I'm excited to welcome you to the 2020 Chicago Business Opportunity Fair and this very special webinar today as part of our CBOF53 virtual conference series. On behalf of the Chicago MSDC Board of Directors, the Northwest Indiana MSDC team, their staff, and the entire team of the Chicago MSDC in Chicago, which includes all of our MBDA centers locally and in St. Louis, welcome again. Connecting the dots, our theme for the 53rd annual Chicago Business Opportunity Fair is appropriately titled, as the pandemic has forced us to all professionally and personally think and perform differently, engage and utilize technology differently, yet remain connected. It is forcing us to be resilient. I'd like to thank our presenting sponsor, Allstate. In addition, thank you to all of our sponsors for this year's Opportunity Fair. Our benefactor sponsorship, United Airlines, our diamond sponsors, BP, Exelon, MBDA, and Rose International, our platinum sponsor, AbbVie, Anchor Staff, and People's Gas, our gold sponsor, Blue Cross Blue Shield of Illinois, Burns and McDonald, Caesars, Harrah's Entertainment, Camelot, Illinois, the CRS Group, Descato Incorporated, Grand Victoria, Illini Care, MZI Group, National Materials, Nicor Gas, PepsiCo, Tovar Snow Professionals, University of Illinois, and Worldwide Technologies. Our silver sponsors, B&B Maintenance, Baxter, BNSF Railway, Hollywood Casino, KFA Incorporated, Moti Tech Industries, Northern Trust, and University of Chicago, and our copper sponsors, Nexus Pharmaceuticals, Walgreens, and Water IT. I also want to thank all of our planning committee team members, partners, and producers like CEI Media Group, who helped us bring CBOF 53 to life. Lastly, a big shout out to our three honorary chairs of CBOF for their leadership and partnership. Sue Bhatia, founder and chairwoman of Rose International. Joyce Johnson, owner of Anchor Staffing. Rona Forte, senior supplier diversity business manager, global community engagement for United Airlines. Not only is Ms. Forte one of our esteemed honorary chairs, but she joins us today to introduce our keynote speaker, Mary Spio. But before I turn it over to Rona, I want to first say a huge, huge thank you to Mary Spio. Mary signed on to be the CBOF53 keynote speaker for the annual sponsors breakfast at Navy Pier this year. This was before we knew a pandemic would change everything we all had planned for this 2020 CBOF53. As we pivoted to a virtual webinar series over the past few months with programming, Mary remained committed and agreed to speak with us virtually. And she's coming to us live from London with her family. So thank you for this commitment, Mary. Mary's company, CEEK VR, recently moved its central operations to Chicago, Illinois. So we are proud and excited to have CEEK in our city of big shoulders and engage with the Chicago Council. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Ms. Rona Forte, who again leads supplier diversity, business management, and global community engagement for United Airlines. Rona.
Thank you, Vince. Good morning, everyone. I am pleased and honored to have an opportunity to introduce our keynote speaker, Mary Spio. Without even having met Mary when I took on the role of chair for the Chicago Business Opportunity Fair 53, I immediately fell in love with her background. If there is ever, and I've seen a lot of things in my 20 plus years of supplier diversity business development work, if there's ever a leader in her space that could be named, Mary definitely stands out as one. So I'm honored to be able to introduce Mary and learn more from her today as she provides the keynote address. Mary is the founder and the CEO of CEEK VR Incorporated, an online virtual reality streaming platform for entertainment, training, and education. This past weekend, CEEK's Black Love virtual concert featuring musical artists Sarkodie from Ghana, Africa, nearly crashed the internet, pulling traffic from more than 1.5 million users across the globe to watch the performance. Mary is a true pioneer. Mary's patented award technologies helped create Boeing Industries' changing digital cinema technology, which revolutionized how movies are distributed. Mary is a speaker for the U.S. Department of State and a scientific reviewer for the Department of Defense. Through her companies, Mary has created technology for various brands, including Xbox, Coca-Cola, and Universal Music. Mary is the creator of the world's first 4D audio headphones for virtual reality, ASMR, music, and more. Mary is also credited for more than 10 technology patents in satellite streaming, virtual reality, and blockchain technologies. She's the author of It's Not Rocket Science, 7 Game-Changing Traits for Uncommon Success, published by Penguin Books, where she advises people to move out of their comfort zones to create global impact and transformation. We can't cover all of Mary's accolades in this introduction, but certainly we are very impressed and excited that she has joined us today. Welcome, Mary Spio. Mary?
Thank you very much for that amazing introduction. I'm super, super excited to be here and very honored to be here. And thank you so much for this phenomenal event. I'm very, very honored to be, given the keynote. And I welcome all the participants that are here with us today. Before I go into the presentation, I will go ahead and play a very short video, which will put everything in perspective for what I'm getting ready to discuss.
fascinates me about virtual reality is the ability to actually put you in a totally different place, in a totally different world. And you can walk inside of that world and you can look all around, you can look up, down, the same way that you would look in the physical world, but you are inside the content. That's what virtual reality does. Today, we have very powerful mobile phones that are capable of rendering virtual reality technologies.
So this is a technology that's really come of age recently. And Mary, through her company CEEK, is right on the cutting edge.
Wherever she's put her hand and then pointed her vision, just you've seen phenomenal results. It's almost as if she was destined or born to do this.
So my career, a lot of times people say, well, how do you go from being a deep space engineer, you know, launching rockets into space to now you're working on virtual reality and entertainment and all of that. But it's really, my career is just one big evolution and it's evolved with how media has evolved. I guess wherever I go, it's basically where media is going. I just stay ahead of it.
CEEK is so innovative, and that is because Mary is so innovative. Being on her own with a smaller company enables her to develop one technology after the other. They are all patented, they are all innovative, and they are all marketable.
What I'm doing now is CVR, we're able to partner with all these companies. Well, Tribune News Company has used our technology, Coca-Cola Company, Xbox, MS Communications, Gatorade, Universal Music with over 32 labels. Oh, Apple. So this year we won the Clio for our VR experience that we created with Megadeth.
Think of when you think of Mary Spio, you know, someone that really cares, has passion, but more importantly, wants positive change, change for all.
I was born in Syracuse, but I grew up in Ghana. I was about 8 years or so when the government was overtaken by military rogues. So I escaped through television. It was our magic box. It was our place where we could escape. I saw stuff on space exploration, people walking on the moon. It was also where I began to wonder what it would feel like to be inside of the television.
Mary Spio, take a look at how her childhood hobby turned out to be her true calling in life.
I dreamed of coming to America as the place where anything was possible. And, you know, I always say I received my Jedi powers with my degree because I could not believe the amount of opportunities that were available to me. The Boeing company came calling to come up with a technology for distributing movies of a satellite. I was one of three engineers that Boeing hired. We came up with the entire design and rolled it out to 30,000 theaters. The digital cinema technology, you see that three of the ground floor patents, I'm listed as a sole inventor. Star Wars Episode II was the first movie that we distributed over Boeing Digital Cinema.
Jewelry experience is one very emotionally driven. Vitrine, as part of the Berkshire Hathaway Corporation, one of our major projects should be what we call the Future Store. And Mary both creatively showed us the direction that we should be pursuing, the items that we should be concentrating on. Whatever we had thought of, she doubled our thinking.
Through my book, It's Not Rocket Science, and then also at working with the U.S. Department of State to be an ambassador of innovation and entrepreneurship. And I do that because I want to be able to encourage people to think much bigger.
I believe that my life is a simple example of some of the possibilities that we're able to access with technology.
If Boeing hadn't given me the opportunity, digital cinema created an entire industry just from this African child. You know, when you look at my pictures from growing up, I looked no different than the kids that you see in the UNICEF commercial. And so when I see the same kids and the same people that everybody walks past, I don't walk past those people. I don't look past those people because those the people, that's me.
Yesterday we had Steve Jobs. Today we have Mark Zuckerberg. Tomorrow we have Mary Spio. And that's the way history shall remember it.
The final words that my dad said to me as I left my journey for America when I was 16, and he said to me, my daughter, my dream for you is to always see our world with that sense of wonder. And my hope for you is that you'll make magic wherever you point your focus.
So I believe that magic really, thank you. It's kind of weird with a virtual audience, right? But I believe that that magic is what we're creating, you know, here at CEEK VR, which is a streaming platform for virtual events and experiences. So no matter where you are in the world, once you put on our VR headset and with our app, now you can be that kid anywhere in the world and be in a summer camp with a three-time, you know, NBA champion winner. You can be in a concert with Ziggy Marley or anybody, your favorite artist. You can be in a classroom somewhere studying, you know, anatomy and chemistry and all sorts of subjects just by putting on the virtual reality. So it is, you know, truly magical. And what we do at CEEK is we've made it very, very simple for content creators and particularly people in the music industry and also in education, and then also even for training, to be able to create virtual reality experiences and make it available no matter where, you know, no matter what device the user is using. And that's something that's very, very different from what anybody's doing in the marketplace. The fact that you can, content creators can upload their content to a platform once, and then it's available on all these different virtual reality headsets, mobile, as well as even smart TVs and desktop, and really anywhere where they can consume that content. That is what, you know, we do at CEEK. My background, I'm going to skip that. But when you think about, you know, what's happening today, what really is virtual reality? Virtual reality is the 3D web. We had web 1.0, which was about pictures and text. You know, we had companies like Amazon that came out of web 1.0. Then you had web 2.0, which was about video and social media and interactivity with other people through the social media platforms. But what's happening now is we're going towards web 3.0, which is the metaverse. And the metaverse, if you look here, is an interconnected world where everyone has a virtual equivalent of their physical world inside of this world, and then we all connect to it. So I could invite someone to come into my house and they'll walk through the front door. We can walk over to the Nike store and try on shoes virtually. We can walk over to a cinema. We can walk over to the CEEK theater. And that's pretty much what we're building now. We're building the gathering places of the future, the meeting places of the future. And people will be able to go into this world and do so many amazing things, you know, that we never even imagined. When the way CEEK came about, I was at, you know, Facebook a few years back. And at that time, they were looking at the Oculus. They were looking at acquiring the Oculus, which they later acquired for $3 billion. And I tried on the Oculus VR headset. And I was taken back to being that kid in front of the television, wondering what it would feel like to actually walk on the moon. But this time I didn't have to imagine anymore because I was actually walking on the moon. I knew with that instant that, you know, media had taken, that we had turned a corner, because now you could actually, you would truly be only limited by your own imagination, because you could go anywhere and be anywhere. And so I set out, I knew that it would be very impactful, not just for concerts, but also for education. Because think of, I became a deep space scientist from seeing a show on a black and white television that inspired me to think about, you know, what it would be like. And I followed that curiosity to become a deep space scientist. I followed that curiosity. You know, I came back from Ghana at 16, got a job at McDonald's. That was my first job. I was a fry cook there. And then, you know, went into the military. I joined the Air Force, got my degree there, and then went to college to study electrical engineering and computer science. But, you know, even throughout my journey, I had never really been exposed to engineering or technology. So it was when I was in the Air Force that, you know, everyone told me, wow, you're really good with the equipment, with the satellite equipment, with the terrestrial equipment, with the crypto equipment and all of that. And so I was able to then compete for scholarship to go back to school. So if I could get all of that from watching a show on TV, now imagine what it would feel like if we can put people on the moon, in the space station, show them, you know, real biological and very concrete and complex concepts that you cannot visualize or get from reading a book. So I set out to create something that went beyond gaming. I wanted to have a platform that would allow people to have all these different experiences, relaxation, music, and so on, beyond gaming. And that's what CEEK is. And so today on the platform, when you come in, you can go, you could teleport to all these different places. You can watch music concerts, you can meditate. We find that a lot of people are actually coming into the platform just to, you know, unplug, right? They're plugging in to unplug. But this is what we're building, which is the virtual venues of the future. So before CEEK, this is what virtual reality looked like. It was very, very complicated. This is actually one company's version of a mobile VR headset where you would strap a computer to your back and then you'd be able to walk around and hope that, you know, you don't encounter death by VR with the cords wrapping around. This was the idea of VR. And a big part of it, when I look at the industry, is because it's not very diverse. It's all the same people talking to the same people. Even when you look at VR headsets, you know, early VR headsets, I would try them on and I would get really sick. And most women would try them on and also get sick. And so you would try to get them to experience something and they'll say, no, 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 maybe my brother or, you know, somebody else. So I started to look into why a lot of people, particularly women and children, were getting sick with VR. And I found that most of the testing had been done on men. So they hadn't actually developed technology, even with the lenses, the dynamic range started outside of what would allow children to be able to have a comfortable experience. The eye distance adjustment, you know, that would allow you to get comfortable in the VR headset. There was nothing there. And again, it was outside of the dynamic range that would make it comfortable, you know, for women, because, you know, physiologically men and women are different. And these differences no one had considered. Not because they didn't want to, because everybody wants to sell a lot, but it speaks to diversity. The fact that you had all the same types of people building for the whole world, you know, and you didn't have any women and you didn't have any minorities. So a lot of what was being built just was not relatable, and it didn't have the cool factor for, you know, the general audiences. So, which is why I came up with my own VR headset. And the first thing I did is first I developed a patented lens, which has a dynamic range that covers both men and women. And then also we made sure that there was the eye distance adjustment, most importantly, that allowed both children, the whole family, to have a comfortable VR experience, and also made it super simple. I was looking at numbers where most of the major social networks, Facebook, Instagram, most of these companies had 80% or more of their users that were on mobile. So I quite didn't understand why all the focus was being put on desktop devices. I also knew, having come from Ghana, having lived in Ghana and other parts of the world, I knew that whatever I was developing had to be able to fit the global market. And that meant that it had to be mobile first. So I developed the mobile VR headset. Believe it or not, there was not a lot. You would think that, you know, the big guys would have figured it out, but they hadn't figured it out yet. And so this was one of the first mobile VR headsets that was developed. It's also patented, patent has already been issued. And then also develop the foldable mobile VR headset to make it affordable, you know, for everyone. But the great thing that it did is it made VR super, super simple and made it attractive to mainstream audiences, because there was no way to scale to billions of people. There was no way to get people using virtual reality the way they use Facebook today, the way they use Instagram today, keeping it the way it was, where, you know, a child would have to strap this big computer to their back, or anyone, you know, for that matter, would have to do that. So these are the products that came out as a result of, you know, looking at the industry and seeing the gaps that needed to be filled in. I also came up with a controller, which was the first VR controller that ever to hit the market. You know, it's the first patented VR controller. And this one came because I was at a Facebook Oculus conference. And I remember asking their chief scientist, who had demonstrated how to move around with the gaming controller. And I said to him, well, what do you do if you don't know how to use a gaming controller? And it was a room full of males, and everybody started laughing, said, who doesn't know how to use a VR controller? You know, and that's what they said. And that was a wonderful moment of insight for me, because I said, wow, these people don't get it. So the first thing I did, I went home and I developed a mobile controller for people that are not familiar with gaming. And it was patented, patent was issued. Today, Oculus, the same people that laughed when I was asking about how people will maneuver, launched their product, and then found out that, well, most of the world does not know how to use this controller, and it's also uncomfortable. So they developed theirs. Everyone has a mobile controller. So, you know, there's a thing that I always say, that don't clip your wings to fit into somebody else's mold of you. That was a typical example of me not feeling bad about the fact that, you know, these other people's reality was not consistent with, you know, what I could see very clearly. So the VR market today, where it is where, you know, before CEEK, it was where MP3s were before iTunes. And this is an analogy that I'm actually borrowing from a buyer at Best Buy. I met with a buyer at Best Buy, and he said to me, you know, what I'm seeing with CEEK is what we saw with Apple and iTunes. Before the iPod, we had a lot of MP3 players that were sitting on the shelf. You had to be a super geek, know how to rip your music, get it on there in order to enjoy music. But then Apple came in with iTunes, the platform, combined it with the iPod so that you can access all your music in one place. And you can be 9 years old or 99 years old, and it's still easy and fun. And that's what you've done. By creating a platform where I don't have to download 1,000 virtual reality apps in order to access an experience, and also paired it with an easy to use, you know, VR headset that anyone can just, you know, put their phone inside and use it. And, you know, you can give this to a 5-year-old or a 10-year-old or, you know, 12-year-old or a 99-year-old, and they have just a greater time. So that's basically what we've done to the VR market today, is made it possible now to have mainstream consumers of content now access, made VR relevant and accessible to them. So today on the CEEK platform, we have programming, we've got everything from, you know, dance, fitness, to behind the scenes, and, you know, anything that you can really think of, you are able to access, you know, through the CEEK virtual reality platform. And we have some amazing, you know, some huge stars. You may recognize some of these names on here. You know, we've got content from Rihanna and Mary J. Blige and Mariah Carey, Nas, and the list goes on. We even did the first ever virtual reality comedy series with D.L. Hughley, you know, iconic D.L. Hughley. And also recently we did the 75th anniversary celebration of Bob Marley. We did a special tribute with Ziggy Marley, and it was available on the platform. And through, you know, we also distributed it through some of the other outlets, and we had, you know, over 10 million people that were able to access the content as a result of being able to distribute our content everywhere. So our model, we have where users can purchase, you know, content as a single piece or through subscription. And of course, we are changing the paradigm with advertising also, because when you come inside of the CEEK platform, as you could see here, the sample that we've done here with Coca-Cola, where when you're walking down the hall, we can literally change the ad that you're seeing. And if you keep staring at it for a certain amount of time, now we can give you a different kind of messaging. So it's very, very non-intrusive and yet very, very immersive. And this is also a different, you know, way that we're allowing people to enjoy VR. You can even come into the virtual world, and if you wanted to, we could have it, you know, rain Smirnoff. I'm sure a lot of people will enjoy that. So partners, we're currently partnered with quite a few people, and that's because of the value that we've brought to the industry. So Universal Music, for example, is one of our partners. Also, these partnerships have been very, very deliberate, you know, because there is, you know, a major problem in Silicon Valley today. And it's not just me talking about it. When you look at the numbers, less than 2% of the funding are going to women. And then when it comes to Black women, it's less than 0.36%. It's even, you know, dire. And so I wanted to be very deliberate in terms of how this company was being built. And that meant, you know, being a small player, that we had to find some really big players and be of value to them. And one such player is Universal Music. Universal Music was approached by every single VR company out there. And because they did not have a solution that would allow them to deliver their content to all these different places, they chose to go with us. And what I meant by that is, for example, you know, I mentioned Oculus was acquired for, you know, $2 billion, $3 billion, because later on there was another billion. But when you look at going up against a company that has $2 billion, you would think, wow. But Universal chose to go with us because we anthropologically understood the music industry. We understood the fact that they needed to be able to do publishing. They needed to be able to have metadata distribution, all the nuances of the industry, you know, and all the difficult things that they needed to solve. We made sure that we had solved with the platform before going to them. So when other people came to them and they would ask them about how they do things like geographic entitlements, and they will, you know, have to be, you know, Googling on the spot in order to answer such questions, we already would pull up our backend and show them, well, this is how you do geographic entitlements, and the fact that we're already integrated with, you know, all the major digital service providers, and this is how many metadata files we have coming in automatically into the backend. So we made sure that we could provide great value to our partners in order for them to be able to use our services. And in essence, it becomes a win-win. And that's how we were able to make some of these partnerships over some of the bigger players that are in the marketplace. And music is a natural for virtual reality. It's a natural because today, of the billions and billions of dollars that are spent on entertainment, it only represents less than 1% of the total possible spend. You know, an example that I love to share is with Adele. Adele had a concert at Madison Square Garden where she only had 100,000 tickets. 10 million people tried to attend that concert. Only 100,000 were able to go. So our platform is here to help partners like Universal sell to those 9.9 million people that couldn't attend those Adele tickets, to sell to the 99% of the world that is still not able globally to attend concerts and events that they would like to, conferences like this virtually. So that's basically what, you know, our platform enables people to do. And for music, it's important to feel the energy. So that was what, you know, we were building pre-COVID. And then, you know, the global pandemic hit and the whole music industry went dark. So what does a global multi-billion dollar industry based on live events do when they can have no live events. They come to CEEK. That's basically what they do. So all of a sudden we had such an influx of, you know, mega artists, you know, Bon Jovi. And, you know, I mentioned, you know, doing the 75th anniversary celebration of Bob Marley, and the list goes on. And today, every single day, another giant shows up at our door looking, you know, for the opportunity to use our platform to distribute their content. Rona mentioned in the beginning, we nearly crashed the internet yesterday. That's how many people were trying to access, you know, the content that we put out yesterday, the concert. So when you look at us today, we serve the function of a Ticketmaster for virtual events and experiences, you know, so that fans can virtually be there at these performances while physically being, you know, anywhere in the world. And it's not just for, you know, mega stars. It's also for up and coming and independent artists. Our goal is to enable everyone to access their fans, you know, to give them back the destiny, take back the destiny in their own hands. So even for smaller artists, for that may have a million fans around the world, but they cannot tour in every single city, we allow them to then directly access their fans through VR. For artists that are not located in the US also, they also have a hard time being able to monetize their content. So you may be in Peru and play a billion streams on YouTube, but if they don't have an advertising agency in Peru, or if they claim they don't have an advertising agency, then you can play it a billion times and still have zero. So we then allow them to come on the platform. Maybe you have a million people pay you, you know, a dollar to access your content versus playing it a billion times, you know, for free. It's the same with different genres. For urban, a lot of urban artists will tell you if they put the same lyrics on a platform like YouTube and Justin Bieber puts the same lyric, their content, they will come back and say it's not brand safe. And then Justin's, they'll come back and say he's brand safe. So he's earning a dollar while Justin is earning 100 for the same identical piece of content, you know, and he's probably getting more views. So all these inequities that are created by algorithms and systems that are in place, we help the, you know, artists to be able to get above those barriers with the platform. You know, looking at some of the success stories that we've had several events where maybe the physical location is around 5,000, but virtually we've been able to, you know, reach over 205,000 people connecting virtually. The event we did yesterday had over 300,000 people connecting virtually. What we did with Megadeth sold out completely. It also allowed the artist to be number one on the Billboard behind Adele and Justin Bieber. And this was a thrash metal band. So it was a significant and, you know, no contest in terms of the contribution that the virtual reality played. That's the package that we ended up winning the Clio for, as well as the Grammy. We've partnered with, we are the only VR company to date that has T-Mobile's net zero rating. So that allows their subscribers to use our content without having to pay data, which is a huge plus. And you know, our goal is really to partner with all the mobile companies because there is nothing better to motivate people to go to 5G or to upgrade their phone. That most of our support emails are people asking what brand of phone they should use and, you know, which mobile carrier has the best service. So if you're out there listening, you know what to do. you know, I mentioned, you know, that we partnered with Apple. All of our users get a $10 iTunes gift card. We're partners with Microsoft as well. And we're the first VR company to actually have a, we were the first, but I think others have the cards now, but we teamed up with Target to create a VR card, a CEEK card for a lot of people that, you know, may not have a credit card. So again, looking at our user base and making sure that as many people can get to our content. CEEK in the future, Especially with the onset, with where we are today, you know, with the global pandemic, we have a lot of educational, partners that are looking to have these classrooms of the future. This is a screenshot from the current app. You could see that this is an avatar that's generated. It's super, super realistic, and it will allow people to sit together as if they're actually there and be able to, you know, look at each other and dialogue. Most recently, Dwayne Wade announced on his, announced on his social media and that he is bringing his camp, which is in Chicago, to virtual. And so his camp now takes place exclusively on the CEEK platform. And we've been able to reach people as far as, you know, Taipei and the list goes on. So this is what we're looking at, into the future, being able to step into the White House to, you know, have a conversation, being able to hospitals develop, you know, VR for hospitals. So pretty much it's an entire world. Whatever, you know, physical world we have today, it's just creating that equivalent. And so we continue to grow. And, you know, that's pretty much covers how we're driving innovation with virtual reality. When we started, you know, we couldn't have foreseen how quickly things will progress to where we are today, where every single company is evaluating, and if they're not, they should be evaluating how they would create a virtual parallel to whatever they're doing today. You know, companies like Twitter and Facebook and the list goes on have announced that they're going to indefinitely have it to where their employees can work remotely. So collaboration, communications, all of that is happening virtually now through VR and also through AR. So now I'll take any questions.
Wow. I think you blew most of our minds with all that. Not only is that exciting, like I'm very, very excited about it, but it also wakes us up to something that I don't think people might catch on to is you were so far ahead of the market, right? So the market needs to catch up to where you are now and say, okay, we have all this technology, this power at our hands because of CEEK. Now we need to think how we can utilize this technology. And so, I'm going to field a couple of questions that are coming through the chat. Of course, I have a few of my own. First of all, how are you doing? I think you're an executive, founder, CEO, running your business from another country with technology. How does all that work?
Well, you know, because everyone was virtual, this is actually the perfect time, you know, to be virtual because we're all virtual today. But even before that, you know, I had a very global marketplace. You know, we have our headquarters in Chicago now, but we have an office, a fully functional office in London with 10 employees. And then we also have, we have developers that are around the world, which is the way we, you know, help move things forward, especially as a startup.
Excellent. That's awesome. So we also are very interested in a couple things. You mentioned, I think this also in the Enterprise Magazine article that you recently did with, or interview that you did with Enterprise, the complexity of bias in venture capital, right? Obviously, you know, being in that marketplace and being way ahead of the game, but competing in a situation where gender is an issue and race, I would assume, is also an issue, and large dollars are being invested in the competitive companies. Mm-hmm. So what do you feel is the change that's necessary in order to make it easier for us to move the technology forward, move our businesses forward?
Absolutely. You know, and I made that analogy in Entrepreneur Magazine that it's like, you know, one person having a bike and another having a fighter jet and having to go and compete, right? And you know, you're pedaling as fast as possible on the bike and you show up, you know, sweaty and everything else. And they're like, oh, you know, what happened? How, you know, why did it take you so long to get here? Because I had to build the bridge and, you know, the bike to ride it over. But the way you get across is you find good partners. That's one way. You know, when you're, you know, when you're the little guy, you got to find the giants. You got to work super hard to find the giants. And today we made a lot of progress. You know, Facebook was, you know, invested in us. Amazon invested in us. So you got to provide value for the giants. And that's what, you know, we've done. And so it's been different because you see a lot of, you know, a lot of the people, a lot of the privileged that are not as careful, which is why when you look at a lot of the stats also, you find that minorities today are returning so many, you know, more ROI on investments that are going into, because, you know, the whole thing about the wounded deer jumping higher than everybody else, we have to work twice as hard, you know, first in, last out, all of that. So you find the giants, you find good giants, and you ride their coattail, which is what we're doing with Microsoft and Facebook and Amazon and all the amazing partners that you're helping, you know, minorities be able to walk in those doors.
Excellent. Let's talk about industry specific now. Obviously, healthcare is on the global radar. Mm-hmm. Have you been approached or is there a conversation about how we can help, training for physicians or training for, first responders? How do we utilize CEEK in the healthcare industry?
So we've actually done a few healthcare projects. So we worked on the first ever infant, child, and adult CPR. We developed a sepsis training module for Baptist Health. Interestingly enough, the module was developed way before COVID. And I found out, you know, recently that the last stage for most of the COVID patients is sepsis. So there is such a huge demand for people to be able to train on sepsis, you know, especially virtually. And so now with modules like that, they're able to train with it. So we have worked in the healthcare industry. We were also one of the companies that Oculus selected to work with, you know, universities such as Yale, NYU, to study the effectiveness of education with virtual reality. So we worked in that, you know, industry and, you know, can continue to offer value there.
That's awesome. That they come knocking on your door every day to speed up this transition as we need to get people on board in the healthcare industry.
Absolutely.
I see a question in the chat. It's coming from Yvette Moten, and she's asking about corporate employee engagement. So opportunities, perhaps training or otherwise for corporations?
Yeah. So any kind of training that you're looking to do, this really lends itself to it. We have studies, you know, some of the things that came out of the studies that, you know, we've done and others that our partners have done indicates that when it comes to training, because most humans are visual beings, we tend to retain better when we're using virtual reality because the mind has not developed the facility to tell the difference between being in the real world and when you're in a virtual world. So for even things like forklift training, there've been studies where they've shown proficiency where people that have learned to do that in VR now can walk onto a forklift and they can operate it as if, you know, they've been, you know, so you can actually gain experience, you can gain memories. So it's very, very effective as a tool. We're seeing use of that with a lot of the deep shore fishing and, you know, other places where it's very, very risky to send the 360 drones out there, bring it back, you know, with other companies, just even showing responsible sourcing by, going inside the mines and showing the employees how to, you know, how they're bringing the diamonds and stuff like that.
Wow. So not only like on the job training, but opportunities for internal training and I guess that type of employee engagement as well.
Absolutely. Visiting different sites. You can, you know, visit different sites. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Especially for those global organizations that they want to reduce their travel budget, right? Cost savings there. Let's get CEEK on the line and get some goggles and some great headphones and get you across the world from your desk.
Yeah, that's true. I, you know, saw that today Zoom is actually worth more than 77 of the leading airline companies because of how much travel has been, you know, disrupted. So I think it's definitely a trend that we're going to continue to see.
Excellent. All right. Sorry, these are spontaneous questions I'm getting, but I think you got it. So I'm going to ask this question about pivoting for schools. So how can we get the schools to think differently about training students, whether it's at a certain level, you know, secondary education or higher, whatever? What would you say we should be doing for the schools?
For the schools, you know, and we've been talking to schools for a very long time. You know, we've talked to a lot of the, not just universities, but also high schools and even junior high. And the schools just have to, you know, especially today when, you know, Chicago School District, Miami, you know, Dade School District, and all these school districts have announced that they're going virtual. This is a great opportunity to really disrupt the way we've been studying, you know, scanning textbooks and putting it on the screen isn't the way we should be moving forward when we have an opportunity to hit the reset button and come back with something that's amazing. And so that's what we're looking for the schools to look at. With the basketball training that we're doing with the Dwayne Wade camp, for example, it's not just basketball. It's we've got all the top elite athletes. We've got LeBron James's trainer. We've got, you know, D Wade himself, you know, who came out of Chicago talking about how, you know, he deals with certain circumstances. It's a combination of life skills, it's a combination of agility, basketball training. We're putting all these different modules together. It's a full curriculum that now we will be able to make programs such as that available to schools for them to use. So now PE, when you think of physical education, it takes on a whole different format. And our goal is to really be able to partner with all these different schools to bring that. At CEEK also, we're even working on a space academy, which will teach kids from 8 years old all the way up to 99. And we will even issue astronaut, you know, licenses that will allow them to train like real astronauts, but it's all formatted. So these are the ways that schools should be thinking. Schools should be partnering with companies such as CEEK to really think about how we disrupt education moving forward. But it would be a loss if we go into, if post-COVID, we go back to doing things the same way that we're doing it. It would have made massive loss of opportunity.
You're absolutely right. I, you know what? I mean, you got me so excited because that's the type of learning that I would have, that would have kept me engrossed in school, and it would not have been so much of a push to get, you know, students to school if they were more engaged in different, using more technology or media. I do want to ask you, and this is maybe a selfish question, but can we get these kids to learn how to drive before we get them to outer space?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, and that's one of the areas that VR will be very, very effective, because even with the CPR training, which was developed for physicians, for clinicians, but then later on was made available to new moms, we had focus groups of even kids that tested out the scenarios. And, you know, we've got video of like an 8 year old telling you when you go into a room, you do your assessment, because they felt like it was a video game. And they also felt that sense of urgency to be able to help that person. So it's a gamification. That's a way that it's the way forward, because especially the, you know, today's generation, they would be able to develop the memory. They'll be able to develop the experience also through driving, and you know, we'll make the road safer. We can simulate a lot of those crashes, like when people are texting and driving and all of that too.
I love that. Can you, I don't know if everyone understands the difference between virtual reality versus augmented reality. Can you explain the difference?
Yes. So with virtual reality, when you put on the VR headset, it removes your physical environment and it replaces it with something completely new. With augmented reality, I could put my phone over, I can put my phone over, let's say this magazine that's there, and then I can get additional information. I could be at a CVS and I look at, you know, and be there with all the different products that are on the shelf. You know, maybe I'm looking for, you know, some kind of hair product, and I could put my phone over it, and then the augmented content will come out so I can learn about that physical product that's out there. So AR adds content, and then VR just replaces it, so you're in a completely different environment. And both of them have different uses that are, you know, are most effective.
Excellent. That's a perfect way of describing that, because I think that the thought process is that that's the only way we can learn, or the type of opportunities for, whether it's training in schools, that's bringing a book to life for a kid, yes. Right? You know,
yes.
So it's one dimensional here, but then I can now see the story in video form, mm-hmm. and now I'm listening to it. I can hear the words and mm-hmm. I retain it better, right? I love that. So thank you for explaining that.
Absolutely.
I think we've got time for one more question. I'm going to ask this. It's coming from Dave Thomas. He asked, so you already know. The question is, will CEEK someday become a publicly traded company he'd like to invest?
Oh, that's...
You don't have to answer that question. Okay. You don't answer. I know, that's a tricky question.
Thank you for that question.
Would you think that when you analyze the different technology in terms of recommending something that small businesses could utilize to transform their business today, so that we don't have so many small businesses closing, is there anything that you can think of that they can start utilizing today?
Absolutely. No matter what industry you're in, you should look at the available technology today and try to figure out, how can I do something creative that will allow me to use this type of technology? You know, recently there was a fashion show, you know, where the owner of the company created all the clothing in, in 3D. Actually, I have a small clip of it. It's like a 1 second clip. I wasn't expecting the question, but, you know, I had something up. But you could see here, this is $1 trillion. These are all. So this is, you know, this, for example, is one way that, this particular company looked at, well, how do I look at the 3D technologies and be able to come up with something that can leverage it? It's a cost savings. It costs so much, you know, less to get your clothing made in 3D and have a 3D runway, and everybody covered it, Vogue and, you know, everybody out there covered it. And so then that allows, you know, maybe a clothing buyer to be able to see it and say, well, we want to be able to bring your fashion line, you know, into our store. So those are some of the ways. How can you build your virtual storefront? Those are all ways to look at how you can build your virtual storefront so that, you know, the whole globe can have access to it.
Right. Right. I think, like, your brain has so much information and so much creativity that that you're a solution provider, right? It's that innovation that you bring to the table when someone has a problem, whether it's a company that, you know, is a janitorial company. It's like, oh yeah, but I can show you that all these products that you have should be demonstrated so people understand when to use this product versus another. And that's the incredible part that I am so impressed with, is your ability to take all this complexity in the marketplace and bring it down to something that's palatable for not only small businesses, but major corporations that just need to think differently. We all need to think differently. So with that, we are out of time. I know there's probably a few more questions, but we'll try to give another opportunity. We really want to see you in person. I don't know if that's going to happen next year, but we really want to see you in person. I can speak on behalf of the Chicago SDC and confirm that. But certainly, we thank you for your time. This has been awesome. I also want to, I can't clap for everyone, but I'll clap for you. Okay? Certainly, we also want to thank the people that make this happen, because you came to us with a great team. Kevin Jordan came in and helped out and got us connected. Sherman Wright came in, yes, and gave us an introduction with Dave Thomas from MBDA Business Center. So we definitely want to thank them. Thank Rona for coming in and Vince as well for providing the introductions today. And once again, thank you. Be safe. We're going to close out this session with a great appreciation for everything that you're doing. And we hope to continue to see your success and see you in Chicago sometime soon.
Thank you. I like your headphones.
Oh, yeah. Do you like my CEEK VR headphones? I got these.
I do.
Myself. Paid myself. And via Amazon, yes. And
thank you for supporting us.
Yes, I will always support. We will always support our businesses. So trust me, anybody that's on this line right now, if you're looking for the best in luxury headphones, this is where you need to be, is with CEEK. Absolutely. No
thank
doubt.
You.
And I can tell you, I love the letter that's inside the box. To me,
thank you.
I know we're over time, but I just want to let you know that was very, very next level and very personal. So I love these headphones.
Oh, thank you. And thank you for doing all those thank yous for me. So I have a great team and amazing people, you know, like yourself and your team and everyone that we're working with. So big thank you to everyone.
Excellent. No problem. So we're going to sign off in just a few minutes here. And thank you for your time. I'm going to pause this. And we'll be done.